In this video, we're going to begin talking about commutators, and in particular, we want to discuss a little bit about their algebra so that you know what we can do when these commutators appear in problems later on. So first, let us remind you, if in case you haven't seen commutators before, what is a commutator? So if we have some operators A and B, their commutator is going to be defined by these square parentheses, these brackets, A, B. And this is going to be, this is a definition, A times B minus B times A. And here we can see that if these two are the same, so basically if A times B is the same as B times A, then this is going to be equal to zero. And if that is the case, then we're going to say that A and B commute. Now, this is very, very important because in the past, especially in classical mechanics, we have been very used to having things commute. Numbers commute, so 3 times 5 is the same as 5 times 3. So that is something that we are used to, and many times we just rearrange things anyway because it doesn't matter. Slowly now, as we advance in physics, it is going to begin to matter. So you should be very careful whenever you rearrange an equation to make sure that if you flip anything, you have to make sure that it commutes. And if it doesn't commute, then you need to determine its commutation relation. Right? Basically, if you know that this is some number A, for example, then you know, oh, okay, if I have AB and I want to write it as BA instead, then you can just see, for example, that BA is going to be AB minus A, for example, right? And that way you can work with your problem. This is something that, well, it is used all day in quantum field theory, for example, especially with anti-commutators, but that is getting ahead of myself. It is applied everywhere. That's just the first example that I thought of. Maybe not the best example, but anyways. And as I mentioned, the anti-commutator is defined similarly, although we are not going to be using it for now, but it is good to know that it exists. This is basically the opposite procedure. So instead of minus, it's going to be summing these quantities, right? And if this is zero, then you say that these operators anti-commute, and you can also determine the anti-commutation relation. Now, it is very important to know why do we care if things commute apart from the algebra. There's actually a very, very deep meaning for commutation of operators, because if the two operators commute, then we call them compatible operators. Basically, what this is going to be is that we can determine both of them simultaneously. We're actually going to see in the next video that the uncertainty principle that we just briefly stated at the beginning of this course can actually be rewritten as the commutator between two operators. And unless the commutator is zero, there is going to be an uncertainty principle. So basically, for any non-compatible observables, there will be some uncertainty just because of the fact that they do not commute. And also, since we discussed the fact that of eigenvalues and eigenvectors in the past video, it is good to note that if two operators commute, right, if their commutator is zero, then they can be simultaneously diagonalized, right? And that is also going to be very important. And they're going to have, and what this means is that they're going to have these shared eigenfunctions, and that's going to be extremely, extremely important in what we're going to do in the future with angular momentum. But if it's not all that clear for now, don't worry, because it all gets much, much clearer when we can finally begin applying. But it is good to at least once go through this. Another important property, or at least a first important property, is that any operator commutes with itself. So if you take the commutator of some operator with itself, that's always going to be zero. And that obviously makes sense. if you look at it from the part from this perspective of it has to be able to be observed with itself, right? And another important properties are that if we have, for example, the commutator of A and B, this is going to be the same as the commutator of minus B and A. And this we can see clearly because if we just take the definition of each of these, this is just AB minus BA, and this here is just minus BA minus and another minus, so we get plus AB. Right? So these two you can see are exactly the same. Another important property, I will change the color here, is what we call the linearity. So if we have the commutator of A and a sum of operators, for example, plus C, plus D, plus and however many operators we might have, this is going to be the same as having the commutator of A and B plus the commutators of A and C, and so on. You just take the commutators of each one of those. And you can also see that just by taking the definition here, because here you would get AB plus AC plus AD plus, I'm omitting these hats for now because I don't want to write it all the time. And then we get minus the other way around. So we get minus BA minus CA minus DA. And here we can see that this part with this is the commutator of A and B. This and this is the commutator of A and C. This and this is the commutator of A and D. So we can see that this relation holds. It is good to know that these properties exist. Maybe they look obvious, but when we are going to be dealing with the problems, commutators appear in quantum mechanics. So it is very important to know to use them when they show up. So even if you don't remember exactly, well, this one might be simple, but if you don't remember exactly the properties, it is good that you know that they exist. Now, another important thing is this relation right here. If we have the commutator of A and the product of two commutators, this is going to be the commutator of A and B times operator C plus operator B times commutators A and C. Now, there's also, for example, a property in the case you have something like A, B, C, D, but this is really huge, so that's why I didn't want to include it. It's not really memorizable, but it is good that you know that these properties exist so that if you find something like that, you can use it. And why is it important? Because many times determining the commutation relation between two operators can actually be quite simple. Sorry. But if you have something like this, this might not be known. But if you can write it in terms of the commutator of A and B and A and C, for example, that might be something that we can actually determine. That's why that is so important. Now, this is the basis of commutators. There is, for example, we could note that any operator is going to commute with any scalar. If B is some complex number, this is going to commute, of course. But those things you can also just see when they pop up. Now I want to do a quick example, although I guess we're also going to do that in the next video, but I'm just going to do it quickly here. Let's just take a look at the operator between the position operator and the momentum operator. Okay, so at least in the x direction, as we're going to prove later in angular momentum, this would commute with the momentum in any other direction than x. So this would be, well, this is going to be, what is operator x? That's just x, right? We are in the position representation where it's just x. Then we have this other operator, which is going to be minus I h bar partial derivative of x. And now comes the reason why I wanted you to take a look at this, because whenever we try to find the commutation relation, it is good to take what is called a test function. So even though we just want to know this, let us include some test function because operators act on some vector or function or whatever. In this case, it's going to be a function. So in order to really understand how to work with it, we need to add a function because, for example, we need to add to make sure that this acts on something. So this is the first term, and then we have minus, but there's also going to be a minus, so we can just turn it into a plus. Plus, and now comes first I h bar, partial with respect to x, and this is a classic mistake that I see. This partial is going to be acting both on x and on this function f. Okay, so don't just let it act on x and then forget about the f. That's why we're including this function, because whenever we actually encounter this, this operator will also be acting on a wave function or some state vector or whatever. So we can't just omit it. So this first part is going to be simple. It's just minus I h bar. We can put it in here because constants commute with any operator. And well, this is just a scalar anyways. Then we have x and then partial of x of f with respect to x. And here we have two terms. So I h bar, and then we have partial of x with respect to x, which is just going to be the function. And then we have plus x times partial of f with respect to x. But that is exactly the same as this right here. So our end result is going to be I h bar times the test function. But remember, that is just a test function. We only took it because we wanted to see what this commutator was. So we can now actually just drop it. And from here, we can see the commutator between the position operator and the momentum operator in the x direction is going to be I h bar. Okay, so that is how, this is just an example how to determine a commutator. They might be easier, they might be harder, but this is the basic idea. It's very important to take a test function whenever you want to determine it. So that is it for this video. I will see you in the next one, where we will finally go ahead and derive the generalized uncertainty principle. I will see you then.